today, we'll have a reception next door in honor of our newest deacon, Bob Noblet. And then church council will meet at 12:15 in the Koinonia Center, and school board will be following that at 1 o'clock. No BYC today, so there we are. American Heritage Girls and Trail Life on Monday. Case for Christ returns on Wednesday at 7 o'clock. Women of Life Bible Study Thursday at 7. And Friday we have a birthday and an anniversary. So we want to wish a happy birthday to Christian Vicker. And a happy anniversary to Chris and Nicole. Next Sunday will be Sunday School for All Ages and worship celebration, our normal time, and DYC will be back on track at noon. And then a reminder, and Audrey is not... Oh, you got the ticket?
They'll be here. Huh? They'll be here before church is over. She's on the way over here.
Okay. All right. This is the last Sunday for tickets for the quilt, for the project. So be sure to see Audrey and get that. Get that taken care of.
Which is Monday.
Oh, next Sunday is the last Sunday. There you are. Okay. Monday will be the drawing. The 19th will be the drawing for the quilt. So be sure. This is our Stars and Stripes Award project for Audrey, and this is what will go to the prayer garden, or project for Stars and Stripes. So just a reminder of that. Our call to worship this morning is from Deuteronomy, the 10th chapter, the 17th verse. For the Lord your God is the God of gods and the Lord of lords, the great, the mighty, and the awesome God who does not show partiality. Let's stand together and worship. Forgive the sins and transgressions of those who truly repent. We ask this morning that you look with compassion upon your people. Hear their supplications. We have sinned against you and are unworthy of your goodness and love. Remember not our transgressions. Have mercy upon us and help us, O God. Grant us remission of all our sins. Give us the grace of your Holy Spirit, that we may amend our ways and with you obtain everlasting life. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
As I wait,
and as I wait.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits on the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From hence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated, and I invite you to turn your Bibles to our first lesson from the prophet Jeremiah.
Our Old Testament lesson is written in Jeremiah chapter 18, verses 1 through 6. Jeremiah chapter 18, beginning with the first verse. The word which came to Jeremiah from the Lord, saying, "Arise and go down to the potter's house, and there I will announce my words to you." Then I went down to the potter's house, and there he was, making something on the wheel. But the vessel that he was making of clay was spoiled in the hand of the potter. So he remade it into another vessel, as it pleased the potter to make. Then the word of the Lord came to me, saying, "Can I not, O house of Israel, deal with you as this potter does?" declares the Lord. "Behold, like the clay in the potter's hand, so are you in my hand, O house of Israel." Our New Testament lesson is written in Romans, the 9th chapter, beginning with the 14th verse. Romans chapter 9. Beginning at verse 14. What shall we say then? There is no injustice with God, is there? May it never be, for he says to Moses, "I will have mercy on whom I have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I have compassion." So then it does not depend on the man who wills or the man who runs, but on God who has mercy. For the scripture says to Pharaoh, "For this very purpose I raised you up, to demonstrate my power in you, and that my name might be proclaimed throughout the whole earth." So then, he has mercy on whom he desires, and he hardens whom he desires. You will say to me then, "Why does he still find fault? For who resists his will? On the contrary, who are you, O man, who answers back to God? The thing molded will not say to the molder, 'Why did you make me like this?' will it? Or does not the potter have a right over clay to make from the same lump one vessel for honorable use and another for common use? What if God, although willing to demonstrate his wrath and to make his power known, endured with much patience vessels of wrath prepared for destruction? And he did so to make known the riches of his glory upon vessels of mercy, which he prepared beforehand for glory. Even us, whom he also called, not from among Jews only, but also from among Gentiles." This is the word of the Lord.
Please stand with me for our gospel. This morning's gospel is from the Gospel of Isaiah. What we have to remember is the last half of Isaiah is good news. And so we're going to focus on that good news as our gospel this morning. beginning with verse 6, chapter 64. For all of us have become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like filthy garments, and all of us wither like a leaf. And our iniquities, like the wind, take us away. There is no one who calls on your name who arouses himself to take hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and have delivered us into the power of our iniquities. But now, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay, and you are potter, and all of us are the work of your hand. Remain standing as we continue to live.
School of Pharmacy,
and its nursing program, excellent nursing program. It's a neat, clean campus just nestled on the northern edge of the city of Weatherford. I've shared Weatherford in the past before, particularly as it relates to the hometown of astronaut Tom Stafford. As clean as that campus was, there was one building that was absolutely filthy. It was the art building. And not only was stuff just thrown all over, but on the bottom floor of that four-story building, there was always dust. In fact, there was so much dust that as you walked, you left footprints on the floor. You see, the bottom floor was designated for the potters. The stained aprons that were thrown over the chairs were such a contrast to the crisp white lab coats hanging in the pharmacy department. Chunks of mud as clay. You're not familiar with being a potter. Chunks of mud were everywhere. And yet, out of that pigsty came the most beautiful pieces of pottery. Have you ever heard the term dumpster diving? Describes the activity of people who are either very thrifty or desperate, faking around the garbage cans and dumpsters to salvage items that others have thrown out. When it comes to you and me, our lives are like items tossed into the trash. We're ruined. We're broken. But our God can reach down and just pluck us up out of the garbage. He lifts us out. He cleans us up. And He remolds us into something beautiful and useful. These are the remolding hands of God. God takes your messed up life in His hands and He says to you, I want to give you a second chance. Now, there is such a thing as restoration. And that takes special hands as well. I remember when I was picking up light fixtures for Moe Hall at Home Depot a number of years ago, backing out of my parking space to leave the parking lot, just as another car was also backing out. And the left rear door of my car had to be replaced, and there was a dent just above the door. And when I got it back from the body shop, it looked like me. My Uncle Wally had such hands. He would take thrown away bicycles. He'd find them in the trash in the dump. And when he was done working on a bicycle, you could not tell the difference between his and those just shipped from the factory. I thank God for hands like that. Restoration is extremely valuable, and yet it's different from what the potter does. Our Heavenly Father calls for restoration, and yet His are remolding hands. Damaged and old discarded cars and bikes can look like new, but they look like they once did. And that's why God's remolding hands are so significant. His are the potter's hands. He completely changes the end result. He breaks that clay, that mud down into a lump and sculpts and reshapes it into something brand new. And I thank God for hands like his, because all of us have messed up at some point. All of us have ruined something in our lives. Maybe ruin everything. Praise God for his remolding hands. We've looked from time to time at the United Kingdom of Israel under Saul and David and Solomon. And we've discussed the divided kingdom after Solomon of Israel and Judah. And the fact dealing with the northern kingdom of Israel, something that was very significant, there was not what? Not one good king in all of the northern kingdom of Israel. Every one of the kings in that northern nation were horrible. But that doesn't mean that the southern kingdom of Judah had all good kings. They had a share of good kings, but they also had some losers. And so this morning I want to begin by sharing about the most wicked king of the southern kingdom, the nation of Judah. And here's a perfect example of what we're talking about, the remolding hands of God. And we're going to see that in the life of King Manasseh. Manasseh was the son of one of the greatest kings of Judah, King Hezekiah. Hezekiah was the king who was responsible for destroying all the high places and especially destroying the Nehushtan. You remember what the Nehushtan was? What does Nehushtan mean? Bronze thing. Does that ring a bell? The bronze thing. Do we remember when Israel sinned and God sent poisonous vipers? And when they were bitten, people were bitten, they died. And Moses interceded on behalf of the people, cried out to God, and God took pity. And God told Moses, you put a bronze serpent on the top of the pole, and you put it in the center of the camp. And everyone who is bitten, if they look at that serpent, will not die. They carried that pole for over 400 years. They erected that pole along with the idols, the false gods that they were worshiping. And it took Hezekiah tear down, to destroy that bronze thing, that hushed. No longer would they worship it. Oh, and we just came off of Lent, came off of Holy Week. What did Jesus say to Nicodemus? Do I dare focus on you? It was our memory verse last month for school, our monthly memory verse. Jesus told Nicodemus, just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, so that all who would look to him would have eternal life. That's the Nehushtan. Hezekiah destroyed it. So much for our quiz this morning. We may try another one, but I have my doubts. So, Hezekiah was the king that was responsible for leading the people back to the worship of the one true God. And you can read about him, if you want to mark this down in your notes. You can read about him in 2 Kings 18 through 20. That's chapters, not verses. And 2 Chronicles 29 through 32, also chapters. But King Hezekiah, tremendous servant of God. And these are the words that were recorded in 2 Kings 18:5. He, referring to Hezekiah, trusted in the Lord, the God of Israel, so that after him there was none like him among all the kings of Judah, nor among those who went before him. Quite a testimony, isn't it? None. He was the top. Enter King Manasseh. So turn with me in your Bibles to 2 Chronicles. We're going to look at some verses there. 2 Chronicles 33. And we're going to look at the first six verses to begin with. 2 Chronicles 33, beginning with verse 1. Manasseh was 12 years old when he became king. And he reigned 55 years in Jerusalem. He did evil in the sight of the Lord, according to the abominations of the nations whom the Lord disposed before the sons of Israel. For he rebuilt the high places where Hezekiah his father had broken down. He also erected altars for the Baals and made Asherim and worshiped all the hosts of heaven and served them. He built altars in the house of the Lord, of which the Lord said, my name shall be in Jerusalem forever. For he built altars for all the host of heaven in the two courts of the house of the Lord. He made his sons pass through the fire in the valley of Ben-Hinnom, and he practiced witchcraft, used divination, practiced sorcery, and dealt with mediums and spiritists. He did much evil in the sight of the Lord, provoking him, capital H, provoking God to anger. Get the picture? In case you didn't, look at verse 9. Thus Manasseh misled Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem to do more evil than the nations whom the Lord destroyed before the sons of Israel. He did more damage to God's people than the heathens that were in the land before Joshua conquered it. One of the principles that we try to instill in the lives of young people is the reality of consequences for our actions. We try to instill that in those of you who are older as well, but it's just easier in the younger years. So what were the consequences for the worst of the worst kings of Judah? King Manasseh. Verses 10 and 11. The Lord spoke to Manasseh and his people, but they paid no attention. Therefore the Lord brought the commanders of the army of the king of Assyria against them, and they captured Manasseh with hooks, bound him with bronze chains, and took him to Babylon. Sometimes it takes us to that point of hitting bottom, whether it's being fired from our job, losing our car, losing our home, losing our family. It takes the hitting the bottom of the pit that jars us into reality. I like to refer to it as being hit alongside the head with a 2x4. Wake us up to reality. Verses 12 and 13. When he was in distress, he entreated the Lord his God and humbled himself greatly before the God of his fathers. When he prayed to him, he, again, capital H, God was moved by his entreaty and heard his supplication, and brought him again to Jerusalem to his kingdom. Then Manasseh knew that the Lord was God. Manasseh implored the Lord his God. He humbled himself and he prayed. And God heard his prayer, and he gave Manasseh a second chance. He brought him back to the kingdom of Judah. He brought him back to Jerusalem. But the Lord brought him back a completely different man. When you look at the account of Manasseh, you can't help but believe that our God is the God of second chances. And if you're struggling with the issue of past sin in your life, I offer you a God that will remold, reshape you, just as he remolded King Manasseh. I want to touch on two more accounts. This account is about a rebellious preacher by the name of Jonah. God called Jonah to go to the wicked city of Nineveh, preach against it. Jonah rebelled, went the opposite direction. He sailed into a terrible storm, was thrown into the ocean by the crew, ended up being swallowed up by a whale. And you thought you have had rough days. What did you do when you hit bottom? Jonah, like King Manasseh, turned his heart to the Lord. And Jonah was vomited out of the whale onto dry land. And in Jonah 3:1, we read, now the word of the Lord came to Jonah the second time. First time he wasn't responding. But it came a second time. God's hands are the hands that can pick you up from the sandy beach, clean you up of all the whale vomit. Forgive, forget what you did before, and give you a second chance to serve Him. And then there's the ruined disciple. And if there was anyone who would be considered part of the all-star team, it would have been Peter. He was part of the inner circle. He was the leader. He was second in command, if you will. The very one who professed Jesus as the very Son of God. The very one who said to Jesus, I will die for you. Peter was the very one who denied Jesus. All the disciples ran in fear in Gethsemane, but Peter was the one who not once, not twice, but three times said he didn't know Jesus. The one who used such language the third time that there would be no doubt, cursing, I don't know him. I would have no reason to know him. Can't you see that anyone can blow it? Any one of us can mess up. The good news is that it doesn't end there. There was that morning on the northern edge of the Sea of Galilee, a catch of fish, a fire, breakfast, most importantly, time alone. Three times Peter denied Jesus. Three times. Jesus asked Peter, do you love me? And Peter, in the hands of the master potter, was reshaped to become the principal preacher of Christ to the Jewish nation. And it all makes sense in light of Jeremiah 18. And this is one of the most tender passages of all Scripture. In this portion of Scripture, the nation of Israel is presented as clay in the potter's hand. And if you're here today in need of God's remaking, if you want the hands of God to remold you, to reshape your life, to redirect you, to make you into something useful for Him, and draw comfort from our Lord. Clay was useless. But the potter picked out the impurities from the clay. He put that clay back on the wheel, and with his gentle hands, he worked and worked that pile of glob into some useful vessel. God's word to us today is this: if the potter can do that with clay, God says, I can do that with you. King David knew it very well. Psalm 40, he wrote, I waited patiently for the Lord. He inclined to me and heard my cry. He lifted me up out of the slimy pit, out of the mud and mire. And he set my feet on a rock and gave me a firm place to stand. He put a new song in my mouth, a hymn of praise to our God. Many will see and fear and put their trust in the Lord. Do you need some reshaping today? Do you need the tender hands of God today, like the potter at the wheel? Take that marred clay of your life, remold it, reshape it, give you a second chance. God will do that for you. Turn to Him. Confess your sin to Him. Let Him reshape you. Let Him make something beautiful of your life. We thank you, Lord, for your remolding hands. We thank you for second chances. But most of all, you take where we've been, what we've done, and you reshape us into something beautiful. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Stand. So love me, beautiful. So love me.
as we prepare to come to the Lord's table, we're just going to file along as we've done in the past. I ask the worship team to go first. Just a reminder that the very center section of each tray contains grape juice for those of you who prefer grape juice rather than the wine. And most of all, we just want you to know, we invite you, as you know, Jesus as your Savior, Jesus as Lord of your life, come to his table, because he has already started to make something beautiful of your life. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After the same manner also, when they had supped, he took the cup, and third cup of the four of the Passover, the cup of redemption, cup of blessing. He said, "This cup, the cup of my new covenant, this cup, the blood shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. All of you drink of it in remembrance of me." And the Apostle Paul, when referring to that third cup, reminds us, is not the cup of blessing, which we bless as sharing in the blood of Christ, is not the bread which we break as sharing in the body of Christ? Since there's one bread, we, who are many, are one body, for we all partake of the one bread. Praise you, Lord, for this precious meal that you provided for us. How glorious it is to remember what you've done for us, and your declaration to keep remembering until you return, and we look forward to that day. We look forward to that day when we can feast together with you, marriage supper of the Lamb. Lord, this morning we just rejoice how you provided for Carolyn. Lord, through her surgery and through the healing process and strengthening, and Lord, we just look for you to just continue that process. Restore her completely. Pray for strength and healing for Lou. We lift up Andrea's dad, Lord, for your touch as he fell, for her brother. Just touch them, Lord, and bring healing to their bodies. For Lynn's cousin, Ron, we thank you for your provision for the bypass surgery, Lord. We ask your touch upon him for strength and healing following the stroke. Lord, we pray that your will be done concerning Jeff's interview for his job. And you provide, Lord, and look to you for that provision. Pray for our young people. or continue to watch over them and keep them safe as they return home this evening. Continue to bless them as they're miles away, just the experience that they've had together. Lord, just focusing on you. We ask you to bless our meetings that we'll be following. We look to you for your guidance, for your wisdom, all the decisions to be made. And Lord, we ask for your comfort for Bella Osnes. She's just the loss of her husband and her daughter years prior, and her son not too long ago, and now her daughter-in-law. Lord, we pray for her. Just undergird her through this time. Be with her, especially at the memorial service this coming Saturday. Lord, may your peace rest upon her. May your glory be forever visible to her. We thank you for the prayer that you've given us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please stand for the benediction. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling, to make you stand in the presence of his glory, blameless and with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time, now